Welcome to this session. My name is Alek Antoniewicz, and I'm a software engineer on MongoDB Atlas. In this session, let's talk about hardware. Today, I'll tell you how you can fine-tune available IOPS to achieve optimal database performance. Your business is really taking off, and your MongoDB deployment is under pressure. You've gone through the performance checklist, optimized your queries, built the necessary indexes, enabled caching, yet performance is not quite what it used to be. In general, there are three sources of database performance bottlenecks: CPU, memory, and I/O, where I/O could be either network performance or storage performance. It's scaling storage performance that is the hard part. So today we'll talk about what are IOPS, about different cloud block storage technologies, how available IOPS impacts MongoDB performance, how to choose optimal storage configuration, and how MongoDB Atlas can aid with all of the above. Let's start with what are IOPS. You might have been shopping for a hard drive recently and noticed some numbers on the spec sheet. Capacity says 2 terabytes, that's plenty of space. Sequential read and write speeds sound like large numbers, that's even better. And then you notice these mysterious lines: random read, 4KB, QD 32, up to 500K IOPS, random write, similarly, up to 480K IOPS, and you're not quite sure what to make out of them. So first of all, IOPS stands for input-output operations per second, and it can really be defined in two ways. First of all, as throughput over the block size. So for example, 1500 megabytes per second over a 4 kilobyte block size yields 375,000 IOPS. Otherwise, is the inverse of latency times the number of concurrent threads accessing the storage medium. So for example, 1 over 0.04 milliseconds times 4 threads yields 100,000 IOPS. And there's an asterisk next to concurrency, because ultimately all storage media are limited in how many concurrent operations they can handle. Some of these parameters can be controlled. So typically the block size and concurrency depend on the database, but throughput and latency are determined by hardware, and this is really what we can influence here. There are different ways of benchmarking block storage IOPS. We can look for read or write performance, average or peak performance, sequential IOPS or random IOPS, and IOPS for different block sizes. In this case, we'll focus on average IOPS, typically read IOPS, unless we are talking about a write-heavy database cluster. Random IOPS, mostly at a block size specific to the WireTiger storage engine. And we'll not discount the importance of latency for latency-sensitive workloads. Now let's talk about cloud block storage. There are two technologies that underpin storage these days: solid state drives and hard disk drives. SSDs have high random IOPS and low latency, high sequential throughput, but are moderately durable and fairly expensive. Hard disks, on the other hand, have low random IOPS and high latency, moderate sequential throughput, but are highly durable and fairly cheap. There are really two cloud block storage architectures out there: direct attached storage, also known as DAS, also called by the cloud providers ephemeral storage, instance store, or local SSDs. And these are really disks physically located in the server enclosure. And the storage area network, or SAN, also known by the cloud providers as elastic block store, persistent disks, or managed disks. And these are racks of disks attached to servers via a network interface. We can organize cloud block storage into a neat matrix. Let's focus on direct attached storage first. Direct attached storage features low latency and high IOPS, as the disks are physically inside the server enclosure. But that also makes redundancy difficult, because the moment the server is down, storage is unavailable. The backup process is challenging and is really difficult to resize volumes. Storage is typically not heavily virtualized, There has recently been a new device interface specification called Non-Volatile Memory Express. It replaces legacy technology developed for hard disk drives. It really reduces latency and allows direct attached storage to benefit from the use of SSDs. Now let's look into the storage area network. It features built-in redundancy, and you can easily resize volumes and snapshot data, as it's heavily virtualized. However, it features typically low IOPS and higher latency than direct attached storage, as the data is accessed over a network interface. There are really two SAMBLOC storage categories: IOPS optimized for applications with random storage access patterns, such as databases that are typically backed by SSDs, and throughput optimized for applications that sequentially access storage, like data warehouse applications, that are typically backed by hard drives. In this presentation, we will focus on IOPS optimized storage. An IOPS optimized storage can be further split into two categories: standard IOPS and premium IOPS. Standard IOPS is best for most workloads, and premium IOPS is great for maximum performance that comes at a higher cost. In general, for IO-bound workloads, we would use IOPS optimized storage area networks or direct attached storage volumes. Now let's talk about IOPS and MongoDB performance. In general, we can take a simplistic model, assumes that each find operation takes one IOP, each insert and delete operation takes one IOP plus the number of indexes to update, and each update operation takes two IOPs plus the number of indexes to update. This is likely the upper bound of available IOPS, though. This number will be heavily influenced by the working set, WireTiger storage engine checkpoints, the journal and the log, the document size as compared to the block size, and the presence of analytics queries. Let's look at each of these. A working set are all indexes and common documents that are best kept in RAM. Optimizing working set really reduces the need to access storage and hence the need to provision available IOPS. The WireTiger storage engine first performs writes sequentially to a journal file. Then these changes are persisted in the database files, either every 2 gigabytes or 60 seconds, whichever comes first. And since the journal file is typically stored on a different volume, we don't have to worry about the performance of the journal in most cases. Not all documents are created equal size. And so, for example, if we have a 64 kilobyte document and our block size is 8 kilobytes in size, then we will need 64 over 8 equals 8 IOPS to perform a read or write on that document. Now, aggregation queries require different access patterns from the underlying storage layer, as they typically involve scanning collections. So we have to be wary of any analytics queries that we run on the database. If you're interested in being able to calculate the precise number of IOPS for your collection, there is a great talk by Jay Runkel at MongoDB World 2017 called Sizing MongoDB Clusters. I'm linking it down below. Now let's talk about the optimal storage configuration. In general, we would want to start with standard IOPS storage area networks, move to the premium offering for better performance, and direct attached storage for great write performance or low latency workloads. So for AWS, that means starting with GP2, Elastic Block Store volumes, moving to IO1, provisioned IOPS EBS volumes, and ultimately to NVMe instance store. For Google Cloud, that means starting with zonal SSD persistent disks and moving to local SSDs. And for Azure, that means starting with premium SSD disks, moving to Ultra disks for better performance, and NVMe disks. There is more than IOPS to the performance of the storage layer, though. We still need to look into the data to RAM ratio, into the VM to network and block storage link performance, into what backup options are available for different tiers of cloud storage? And what is the durability and availability of the storage layer? And this is really where MongoDB Atlas comes in. MongoDB Atlas is our fully managed MongoDB as a service in the public cloud, available on the infrastructure of the three major cloud providers. It allows you to easily change available IOPS anytime, autoscale your virtual machine and storage size, transition from storage area networks to direct attached storage, and vice versa, with no downtime. Migrate data between regions for the same cloud provider, and monitor performance, including IOPS. Let's look at the cluster builder for MongoDB Atlas. If you'd like to increase the number of available IOPS for a standard volume in AWS, you just need to increase the size of the storage. That automatically increases the number of available IOPS. For provisioned IOPS, you can increase or decrease the number of IOPS independently of the storage size. And we also feature NVMe clusters for maximum performance with a fixed storage size and a very large number of IOPS. The situation for GCP is even easier. You just need to increase the size of the volume, and that automatically increases the number of IOPS. And the situation is similar for Azure, with the exception that increasing the volume size for Azure requires doubling the size of the volume. So in summary, IOPS stands for input-output operations per second. In case of the MongoDB server, we care about average, read, random IOPS at an 8 kilobyte block size. In general, the better the storage layer, the more IOPS. We can organize cloud block storage into a matrix with direct attached storage and storage area networks. We will mostly focus on IOPS optimized storage area networks because throughput optimized storage area networks are not relevant for database workloads. We can assume a simplistic view where each read, write, or delete operation takes one IOP plus the number of indexes to update, and each update operation takes two IOPS plus the number of indexes to update. It is really important to tune the working set, as this can hugely reduce the requirement for more provisioned IOPS. And it's important to look out for aggregation queries, which means different access patterns. The best idea is to start with standard IOPS storage area networks, then move to the premium offering and to direct attached storage for maximum write performance or low latency. And to sum it all up, MongoDB Atlas makes it very easy to optimize for available IOPS and change them in response to performance demands. Thank you.